Kate McCann stated in her book that she washed Madeleine's pyjamas on the Thursday morning, the 3rd of May, 2007, the day she says Madeleine was abducted. She said it was to wash away a tea stain. After Madeleine was reported missing, the McCanns gave the police a description of the pyjamas in which Madeleine was said to have been stolen from her bed. This photograph appeared in several British newspapers 6 days after Madeleine's reported disappearance. And because the image had been supplied to the press by the Portuguese police, people assumed it was a police photograph taken by the Portuguese police. The image is not, in fact, an official police photograph. It was supplied to the police by the McCanns or somebody associated with the McCanns. In the released Portuguese police files is a note by Detective Constable Markley of Leicestershire Police, written on or after the 8th of May, exhibiting a black and white copy of this photograph, among others, and headed Information from the Family. About a month after the image was featured in the media, on the 5th of June on Crime Watch, and again 2 days later at a press conference in Amsterdam, Jerry McCann held up the very same pair of pyjamas. We know they are the same because they share identical imperfections due to having been worn. At this press conference, the McCanns claimed that these pyjamas belonged to Madeleine's then 2-year-old sister and that they were producing them because they were similar to those Madeleine was wearing when abducted. These pyjamas were most likely from the 2006 range of Marks & Spencer's Eeyore pyjamas, when Madeleine's sister was little more than 1 year old. It is plain that they are far too large to have been bought for someone so young. Even Madeleine's sister herself confirmed they were not hers. Jerry's brother, John McCann, speaking to the media days after Madeleine was reported missing, said that Kate was dressing her in a pair of her sister's pyjamas and she exclaimed, "Maddie's jammies! Where is Maddie?" So there are several lines of evidence that the pyjamas Jerry is holding up, which are the same pyjamas in this image, in fact belonged to Madeleine and not to her younger sister. These are the very same pyjamas that Kate McCann said she washed on the morning they said Madeleine was taken. So if Madeleine's pyjamas were not abducted, neither was Madeleine. The reasons why we now know these pyjamas belong to Madeleine are explained in more detail in these two articles, an article by Madeleine McCann researcher Dr. Martin Roberts and one by Nigel Moore, and I'd like to thank them for their detailed research. Kate said she washed Madeleine's pyjamas on the morning of the day they reported her missing. The pyjamas in this photograph show signs that they are still damp. The blue background cloth in the image is identical to the furniture in the McCann's apartment. If it is true that Kate washed Madeleine's pyjamas on the morning of the 3rd of May 2007, then the McCanns themselves may have taken this photograph on the morning of the day they said she was abducted, ready to hand it to the Portuguese police after the planned abduction hoax which was to follow. This is my fourth release of films exploring the mystery of the alleged disappearance of Madeleine McCann and how Britain's mainstream media have for 10 years withheld from the public many key facts surrounding what happened. In my first set of films, I set out hundreds of facts which to me suggest Madeleine died in her parents' holiday apartment in Pride-de-Luz and that they, perhaps helped by others, for whatever reason, covered up her death. I examined the findings of one of the world's top dog handlers, Martin Grime. His cadaver and blood dogs between them made 17 alerts to the past presence of a corpse and blood. I discussed the McCann's reactions to these dramatic findings.
This is the first time that you give us a big interview, not being a widow's, not being a widow since then. So now I feel free to ask you this directly. How can you explain the coincidence of the scent of the cadaver felt by British and not Portuguese dogs?
Sandra, maybe you should be asking the judiciary because they've examined all this.
But don't you have an explanation for that?
I mean, we're obviously Madeleine's mum and dad, and we're desperate for people to help us find Madeleine, which is why we're here today. The majority of people are inherently good, and I believe the majority of people in Portugal are inherently good people, and we're asking them if they'll help us spread this message to that person or people.
So you don't have any explanation for that?
Ask the dogs, Sandra.
Ask the dogs, no, Jerry. Now I think that I feel free to ask you.
They also claimed the dogs had only alerted to dirty nappies or rotting meat. I dealt with mountains of circumstantial evidence, which in my opinion implicate the McCanns and some of their friends in the cover-up of Madeleine's death. There were irreconcilable contradictions between witness statements. In one case, with the alleged visit of the McCann's friend David Payne to the McCann's apartment at 6:30 p.m, the night Madeleine was reported missing, I identified no fewer than 20 contradictions. I noted several changes of story about the events of the 3rd of May. Whether the apartment was broken into or not, whether the patio door was left unlocked or not, whether the McCann's entered by the front door or not. I looked at changes of story about how the wind was supposed to have blown the curtains open and closed the door shut when Kate McCann supposedly did her 10 p.m. check. I also delved into the extraordinary range of individuals and agencies used by the McCann team for their private investigation. Most of them were thoroughly disreputable and some turned out to be crooks. Two of them, Antonio Gimenez Razo and Kevin Halligan, each spent 4 years in jail on charges respectively of corruption in public office and a $1.5 million fraud. Another, Gary Haglund, was an expert in advising companies on avoiding being accused of money laundering. Others had connections with MI5 and the British Security Services. I then went on to examine the huge involvement of the British establishment in the case from day one. Tony Blair's chief media advisor, Clarence Mitchell, was on the case from the early days. He once boasted that his job was to control what comes out in the media. An assortment of PR men, lawyers, British police and security services, criminal profilers from MI5 and others also descended on Priadulla's in the first few days. The Metropolitan Police Force's supposed six-year-long investigation, Operation Grange, which began in 2011, was set up after Rebecca Brooks, then the CEO of Rupert Murdoch's News International Empire, manipulated David Cameron into action after reportedly threatening him with a week of bad headlines about Theresa May. And it seems now that Operation Grange was never intended to be a real investigation. It was another intelligence tool with which to mislead the public into accepting a bogus abduction claim. Grange was a psychological operation, a psyop. In fact, the whole case has been a 10-year-long psyop. In my second release, I highlighted what I called four phantom abductors. I exposed the claim by Nuno Lorenko that a Polish holidaymaker, Wojciech Krakowski, had tried to kidnap Lorenko's young daughter as an obvious fabrication. I showed how his false claim derailed the Portuguese police investigation in its early stages. I then presented evidence that the McCann's friend, Jane Tanner, had fabricated her claim of seeing a man carrying a child near the McCann's apartment at 9:15 p.m. the night Madeleine was reported missing. After that, I showed that Martin Smith and family from Ireland, who claimed to have seen a man carrying a child at 10 p.m. that night, contacted me to distance himself from Robert Murat, but then failed to reply to my follow-up questions about their alleged sighting. As far as I'm aware, the Smiths have never gone on camera with their account. If they wanted to clear things up about whether they knew Robert Murat, why couldn't they clear up some very basic, unanswered questions about what they said they saw? For these reasons, in my opinion, their account remains another possible fabrication. Finally, I examined the claim by DCI Redwood from the Met's Operation Grange to have found the person that Jane Tanner claimed she saw. He claimed that 6 years after the event, this man had come forward to say that he had been carrying a child home from the night creche that night. Was this man living without a television in a hole in the ground for the previous 6 years? He has never been named, and I believe DCI Redwood should be arrested and charged with perverting the course of justice, as I am fully convinced this was yet another piece of fabricated evidence. In my third release, titled When Madeleine Died, I examined every claimed sighting of Madeleine working backwards from 10 p.m. on the Thursday, the 3rd of May. None of the sightings could be verified until I reached a detailed sighting by a cleaner who had clearly observed the entire McCann family, including Madeleine, at lunchtime on Sunday, the 29th of April. With the help of a retired police superintendent who has studied the Madeleine McCann case for the past 10 years, I was able to present convincing evidence that the so-called last photo of Madeleine, which the McCanns said was taken at 2:29 p.m. on the Thursday, the 3rd of May, was probably taken at lunchtime 4 days earlier on Sunday, the 29th of April. I have concluded there is no credible evidence from other witnesses independent of the McCanns and their friends, that Madeleine was seen alive after Sunday. In November 2016, I travelled to the United States to get the opinion of highly respected statement analyst Peter Hyatt, who is an expert in analysing witness statements for possible deception. I recorded a 2-hour-long interview in which Peter Hyatt analysed an interview the McCanns gave for Australian television in 2011. Although Peter Hyatt had not watched any of my films, he came to identical conclusions.
What I concluded from just this interview itself is that Madeleine is dead, the death was not intentional, that they have disposed of her remains in a hidden manner of which they feel confident will not be found, the cause of death was likely not intended and may have included both causing her to be very sleepy and a fall. They have feared being accused, their concerns about themselves, and that the time frame that they've given must be questioned. Those are things that I conclude strongly. Now, underneath that is the possibility of sexual abuse being part of this equation is strong.
In this release, my fourth set of films, I will deal with two issues I promised earlier to look at. One is the role of the initial chief suspect in this case, Robert Murat. The other is the issue of how Madeleine died and why it was covered up. I believe I have demonstrated in previous films that Madeleine died earlier in the week, and I believe that the McCanns, with the help from many powerful people and millions of pounds donated by the British public, have covered up her tragic fate. From now on in the film, I am assuming Madeleine died during the 2007 holiday and was not abducted. I will not specifically say each time alleged death or allegedly died. I will speak as though this is true, so that the narrative flows better. But I state now that the death is based on my own belief, which is based on the evidence I have revealed. It is not a statement of legal fact. There is no suggestion at all, by the way, that Robert Murat was involved in Madeleine's death. It is the extraordinary things that happened after her death that I shall be examining in relation to Robert Murat. Murat flew out to Portugal from the UK at 7 a.m. on Tuesday, the 1st of May 2007. This is about a day and a half after the time when I believe Madeleine died, and 2.5 days before the McCanns reported Madeleine missing. Murat was born in London in 1973. At the time of Madeleine's reported disappearance, he was just 33 years old. His father, John Murat, was born in Portugal, but he was sent to England to be tutored at the Hillbrow School, an exclusive boarding school in Eastbourne. Later, he went to Bradfield College, where he was a contemporary of comedian Tony Hancock. When Murat was less than 1 month old, his parents moved from England to Portugal, initially living near Lagos, where Mr. Murat Sr. pursued property interests. He died when Murat was 12. Murat's aunt and uncle, Sally and Ralph Everley, also live close by in Burgau. In my first Madeleine film, I filmed at their property, Salsalitas, which was subject to a long search by the Portuguese police following Madeleine's disappearance. Like his parents, Murat's early life was split between Portugal and England. During this time, he became bilingual in Portuguese and English. His early education was at the English language Barlavento School and the International School on the Algarve coast. He was then sent to England to study, finally returning to a secondary school in Lagos until he was 16. Then he went back to England and lived with his maternal grandmother in Sidmouth, Devon for a spell. This unsettled, to-and-fro way of life in England one moment and in Portugal the next may explain the very disturbing statement I am now about to read from. It was a witness statement taken by the Portuguese police from a family friend of the Murats, a Mr. Carlos Costa. I can't guarantee its accuracy, as his evidence hasn't been tested in court, but I believe we should take it into account in order to shed possible light on Murat's psychology before we look at his involvement. He has known Robert Murat for about 25 years. He got to know him while working at Jacinto and Murat from 1982 to 84. At this time, Robert was 8 years old. Immediately one noticed that Robert had a strange personality, staying away from people and not wanting to engage. He had somewhat of a violent attitude. He remembers an episode where Robert, on the veranda on the first floor of the firm, threw vases from that exterior without checking to see if anyone was underneath him. A neighbour told him that Robert had tried to have sexual relations with her mother's cat. The animal responded by scratching him on various parts of his body. These injuries were seen by the deponent, given that he, Robert, had visited the Castelejo beach in Vila do Bispo on various occasions. On one of these occasions, he saw Robert scratching at excoriations. He was told by L that Robert had killed the cat out of spite. He also states that he witnessed a macabre episode perpetrated by Robert. He saw him once again trying to have relations, this time with the family dog, who ended up being forced into the house, situated in Almedina Iras Velas. He states that when he went to the beach with Robert, he, Robert, would stay away from the rest of the group, about 15 to 20 metres, and not say a word to anyone the whole day. He also adds that a cousin of Robert, of British nationality, whose name he does not know, and who lives in his house, has suffered an assault by Robert. For this reason, she left the home. These acts were hidden by Robert's mother, who protected him and who never punished him. At this point, Robert was 16 years old. He would like to add that according to what he knows about Robert, he was not surprised that he was described as a disturbed person and could very easily turn violent. He is also someone with a sadistic and deviant sexual personality, and who is also misanthropic. This is based on contact with him for 15 years. If he did abduct this child, then the witness believes she may be dead. He concludes this from Robert's violent and deviant personality. He adds still that he also was violent with his mother when he was reprimanded and would react by kicking her. He asserts that Robert did receive psychiatric treatment whilst in the UK. So, Mr. Costa describes here a person who was prone to sexual deviance, violence and sadism, and has given specific examples. After Murat left school, he began selling double glazing and then later became a car salesman. He moved to Norfolk, where he again worked for a car sales firm called Inchcape and then for turkey farmer Bernard Matthews. It appears he also worked occasionally as a Portuguese-English interpreter for the police. This experience was to become very relevant in the events following Madeleine's alleged disappearance, as we shall see. At the age of 28, Murat married Dawn, a woman several years older than himself, who already had one child. Murat and Dawn had a child, Sophia, the following year, who was nearly 5 at the time Madeleine was reported missing. Murat persuaded Dawn to move to Portugal. but a few months later they agreed to live separately, Dawn moving back to Norfolk and Murat staying in Portugal with his mother in her home, the Casa Liliana. Murat would visit his daughter from time to time in England. They then agreed to get divorced. The week that the McCanns went on their ill-fated holiday to Portugal, Murat says he was staying with his sister in Sidmouth. He had another sister in nearby Exeter. His grandmother had died, and Murat said he was engaged in renovating her home in Sidmouth. The events begin on Monday, the 30th of April. That was the third day of the McCanns' holiday. It is also the very next day after what I said in my last film was the last credible sighting of Madeleine at lunchtime on Sunday the 29th of April. As my previous film showed, it is probable that Madeleine was already dead by the 30th of April. On that Monday, it is likely that someone spoke by phone to Murat from Portugal on the 30th, which prompted him to come over to Praia da Luz as soon as possible. It has never been clear who made such an all-important call to him. He booked a flight late on the night of the 30th to leave Exeter Airport, just hours before the flight took off at 7 a.m. on Tuesday the 1st of May. Looking at the history of Murat's travel to and from Portugal before May 2007, he says he made trips back to England to see his wife and daughter in these months. So if we look at the records obtained by the Portuguese police, we find him taking a trip back to Portugal on the 2nd of January 2007. He stays there for nearly 3 months and then flies back to England on the 20th of March 2007, ostensibly to refurbish his grandmother's home, or visit his ex-wife and daughter, or maybe both. So he had been back in England for about 6 weeks before someone, we are not sure who, required his urgent presence back in Portugal. The reason it seems sudden or urgent is because there is such little time between him buying the ticket and flying out. If we examine the telephone records from the landline of Robert Murat's mother, Jennifer Murat, these reveal quite intense telephone activity on Monday the 30th of April between her phone and two Exeter telephone numbers, one of them being Murat's sister's phone, where Murat appeared to have been staying at the time. One of these phone calls to a UK landline just after 9 a.m. lasted over an hour. Some of these calls were to a UK mobile phone number. Why was Murat's mother speaking to him that day? Or could someone else have made the call? Michaela Walchuk, his fiancée perhaps? Michaela Walchuk's mobile phone records on that Monday morning show that she made several long phone calls instead of her usual short ones. But whatever calls Murat did receive that may have prompted his early morning flight to Portugal, he boarded the 7 a.m. flight to Faro and was there by 9 a.m. And there to meet him was his mother. Murat was first pulled in by the police for questioning on the 14th of May. They questioned him about his movements from arrival at Faro on the 1st of May up to the morning of the 4th of May after Madeleine was reported missing. Remember, it is assumed Madeleine is already dead before he arrives in Portugal. Here is the record from his first interview. I will give a summary of his movements based on his statement. Tuesday the 1st of May, arrived at 9:30 at the airport in Faro where he was met by his mother. Stopped at a petrol station at the airport exit that had closed toilets. He didn't eat anything or fill up the car. He then drove to the A22 where he stopped at the first service station on the way. He drank a latte coffee, as did his mother. He ate a meat pie, and his mother had a cheese and ham croissant. Soon after that, they went directly to Casa Liliana in Praia da Luz, where he arrived between 11:30 and noon. Without unpacking his suitcase or entering his home, he went in the VW to see Michaela, his fiancée, at the house in Lagos, where she lived with her husband, Louis Antonio, arriving between 12 and 12:30, where he took some gifts for both her and her daughter. Michaela and Louis Antonio were in the process of divorcing. He remained in her house, he thinks, until between 3 and 3:30 p.m., talking with the entire family, including the child's father, Louis Antonio. He then drove himself home, where he arrived at 4 p.m. He does not remember having gone to another place before arriving at his mother's house. Once at home, he does not know if he went out again that day. Wednesday the 2nd of May. He got up at around 9 a.m. and left home between 10 and 10:30 a.m. He went to Lagos in the VW to Michaela's, where he arrived at 10:40. He entered her house and she was alone. He remained there for a short time talking. They left there and went in the VW to the centre of Lagos. He parked in a street and went to the home of Francisco Pagaret, his lawyer, who was not there, but Pagaret's girlfriend was there. Next, he went to meet his future real estate partners in their store called Putos Grados, located in Lagos, whose current line of business is the sale of clothing, owned by Jorge Silva. After the meeting in the store, he went to a cafe with Michaela, Jorge Silva, and Jorge's son Jason. Soon after this, they went to another cafe located in Lagos Marina, which was less noisy, where they talked about business. He had a latte to drink, but does not know if the others did. The bill was paid by Michaela in the first cafe, and he has no idea who paid in the second. They remained in the second cafe until between 10 to 2 and 2 p.m. After the marina, they walked back to the VW, and he then had lunch in the Bembom restaurant in Lagos, this time only with Michaela. They arrived just after 2 o'clock. He ate roast meat, and lunch ended between 3:15 and 3:20. They then went to the school to pick up Michaela's 8-year-old daughter, arriving at around 3:25. They then went back to the home of Pagaret, who this time was present. They spoke with Pagaret about Murat's divorce and about building properties while standing next to the VW. He and Michaela then returned to Michaela's house in Lagos with her daughter. He remained in the apartment with Michaela and her daughter for a long time. Her husband Louis arrived by 9 p.m. or shortly after, when they were having dinner of pork or turkey. He left Michaela's home at between 10:30 and 11 p.m. in the VW and went to his mother's house in Praia da Luz, parked the vehicle in front of the house, spoke with his mother who was awake, played cards on his computer and went to sleep between 1 and 1:30 a.m. He remained at the house until the next morning. Thursday the 3rd of May. He woke up between 8 and 9 a.m, took a bath, dressed, drank some tea, then left the house in the VW at 10. He presumes he went to Lagos to see Michaela. He does not know where he parked the VW. He went up to her apartment, rang the bell, Michaela opened the door. Only Michaela was at home. They talked about the website for their real estate project in the lounge and in the kitchen for quite some time. They left the apartment at around noon in the VW, taking the roads towards Portimao. Before Odiexer, they went round the access roundabout to the A22. 10 to 15 minutes after leaving the apartment, they came to the petrol pumps of the Galp M24 service station on the A22, where they had lunch. They left the service station and returned to the apartment, where they once again spoke about various things. They collected Michaela's daughter from school in the VW at 3:30 p.m, and the three were then met with Jorge Silva and his son, he does not know where, but believes it was at the Lagos Marina. There they went into a cafe whose name he can't recall. It was next to a play area for children where Michaela's daughter played. They spoke about Romagen, their new business venture, and the meeting finished late, he thinks between 6 and 7. Everybody left together, went to the VW, which was parked in the car park at the rear of the marina. They gave a ride to Jorge Silva and his son, dropping them off at the bus station next to the CTT in the city, arriving between 7:15 and 7:30. He parked the VW in front of the house and does not recall if his mother was at home when he arrived, but he thinks so, because it was late for her to walk the dogs, as she usually leaves at 5 and returns at 7. After entering the house, he may have drunk tea and watched television. He may also have read a newspaper. He talked with his mother about Romagen, ate a ham and cheese sandwich, sitting in the kitchen with his mother, until between 10 and 11 p.m. Contrary to what he said originally, he was not with Michaela when she went to a Jehovah's Witness meeting between 8 p.m. and 10 p.m. This is why he didn't phone her, because she turns her phone off in the meetings. He doesn't know if he called her after 10 p.m, but accepts that is a possibility. He was at home with his mother when at 10:30 p.m. or a little later, he heard the siren of an ambulance or police. He commented on that to his mother. However, he did not leave the house to investigate. He did not leave again until the next morning, having gone to bed around midnight.